And with your spirit,
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
Jesus saw the crowds and went up a hill where he sat down. His disciples gathered around him and he began to teach them. Happy are those who now they are spiritually poor. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Happy are those who mourn. They will be comforted. Happy are those who are humble. They will receive what God has promised. Happy are those whose greatest desire is to do what God requires. God will satisfy them fully. Happy are those who are merciful to others. God will be merciful to them. Happy are the pure of heart. They will see God. Happy are those who work for peace. God will call them his children. Happy are those who are persecuted because they do what God requires. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. Happy are you when people insult you and persecute you and tell all kinds of evil lies against you because you are my followers. Be happy and glad, for a great reward is kept for you in heaven. This is how the prophets who lived before you were persecuted. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brothers and sisters, in the third chapter of his apostolic exhortation on the call to the holiness in today's world, Pope Francis proposes the Beatitudes. In the Sermon on the Mount, as a road to attain holiness. So we just read the Gospel, see how Jesus sat down and started preaching. So the first thing he called them, and the how is supposed to be the what we call the Beatitudes. The sermon in the core message of Jesus preaching and teaching and the Beatitudes are the synthesis of this central message that functions as an introduction to the sermon. Jesus is sitting down on a mountain, showing his authority and dignity, teaches disciples the right attitudes, the right characters and actions one should possess to acquire holiness. The term beatitude is derived from the Latin word beatudo, and is equivalent to the Greek term makarios. So beatitudes are pronouncements that confer an end-time blessing upon the persons who are characterized by what they are. They contain a promise and a demand in which Jesus promises happiness for those who live up the values envisage to enter the kingdom of God. So as I was at the beginning, it is a kind of a manifesto of Jesus' party to all people who are there. And then he tells us how we should behave. In his apostolic exhortation, Pope Francis proposes the call to holiness in a practical way for the present time, with all its risks, challenges, and opportunities. According to him, Jesus, the Son of God, who taught the disciples to be perfect, as the Heavenly Father is perfect, invites his hearers into the way of being holy in the world that will result in their true and full blessedness now and in the age to come. He considers Beatitudes as identity cards, as Adar you have. So this identity card of a Christian. And to obtain happiness and holiness. So Beatitudes are Jesus' answer to the question of the disciples about holiness. An answer given in the form of a series of promises and challenges. They are descriptions and commendations of the holy life, which contains happy news for the poor, persecuted, and humiliated crowd. So Jesus offers happiness to become holy people and saints in his own model and example. Hence, they are not created and called to lead an ordinary or mediocre way, because God chose them in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. How can we be holy in our day, in spite of all the challenges and problems, especially in the midst of the Gnosticism and Pelagianism, the two subtle enemies of humility, holiness, and happiness? Jesus gives eight to nine Beatitudes as a program for Christian living, underlining the attitudes that the followers of Jesus should possess. They can also be called the entrance requirements to attain holiness and to enter the kingdom of God. They are the jewels of the Sermon on the Mount and contain the core message of Jesus' teaching to be a holy person, highlighting values of Christian discipleship. Jesus, unlike the Jewish scribes, teaches the disciples as one having authority. The conditions for authentic Christian discipleship, in effect, he demands for a higher righteousness a Christian should possess, a righteousness that goes beyond Jewish righteousness. So I'm not going to explain now all the Beatitudes one by one. I take only the first one, spiritual poverty. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. So holiness is attributed to the poor. The Greek word used for poor is tokos, means needy. The Hebrew term is anau, which literally means bent. The oppressed, the downtrodden, the humble, and the meek. The poor in spirit may or may not be economically poor, but those who are gentle, humble of heart, and interiorly detached from material wealth, they are the poor of Yahweh, because they have realized their utter helplessness and put their trust in Yahweh. Hence, spiritual poverty as an attitude of childlike openness and trust in the providence of God. It is a virtue that humanizes and liberates the disciples and enables them to be open to God, His will, His word, and His kingdom. Such holy people do not have a feeling of self-sufficiency, but express an attitude of non-attachment to material goods. The poor in spirit commit their lives into divine hands and refuse to rebel against His will. So, my dear friends, poverty in spirit is not merely a lack of and detachment from money and material goods. It involves detachment from power and prestige, detachment in the face of criticism, and detachment from the need to have a career, etc. Poverty is material and dehumanizing poverty as a result of injustice and sin. The materially poor lack necessaries required for day-to-day living. They are the needy, marginalized, afflicted, and oppressed who suffer because of social marginalization. However, poverty is neither a hindrance nor a condition for salvation. Jesus in his life shows a preferential option for the poor. He said, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." So according to the Bible, those who rely on wealth are fools. They are content to ignore God in their life, giving priority to enjoyment. The natural tendency of human beings is to find safety and security in material possessions and to long for wealth, honor, name, fame, popularity, prosperity, and long life. So Jesus' teaching implies that the counterculture has to be created, which enables one to lead a plain and austere life like the early Christian community. So, my dear friends, the promise to the poor is that the kingdom of God is theirs. As a principal theological concept in the Sermon on the Mount, the phrase kingdom of God occurs several times. Though the kingdom of God is the central concept of Jesus' preaching and teaching, he does not define it. St. Paul defines kingdom of God as righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The Beatitude not only offers a promise, but it offers a challenge to the poor in spirit. According to Pope Francis, in this letter written to all of us, wealth ensures nothing but makes one think that he is self-satisfied but leaves no room for God's word, for love of the neighbor, whereas poverty makes one rich in humility, which is the root, the mother, and the nurse of all virtues. It brings the joy of holy indifference. This holy indifference has to be kept in all that is permitted to one's free will, so that one does not set his heart on good health rather than bad health, riches, rather than poverty, honor rather than dishonor, a long life rather than a short one. So, dear friends, as we just have gone through the first beatitude, which is the first promise of all those who are poor in spirit, so we just remember. Pope Francis describes each of the Beatitudes concluding his section, being poor of heart, that is holiness. Reacting with meekness and humility, this is holiness. Knowing how to mourn with others, that is holiness. Hungering and thirsting for righteousness, this is holiness. Seeing and acting with mercy, that is holiness. Keeping a heart free of all that tarnishes love, that is holiness. Sowing peace all around us, that is holiness. And accepting daily the path of the gospel, even though it may cause us problems, that is holiness. In the 25th chapter of Matthew's Gospel, Jesus expands on the Beatitudes about mercy. If we seek the holiness pleasing to God's eyes, this text offers us one clear criterion on which we'll be judged. When we recognize Christ in the poor and the suffering, we see into the very heart of Christ his deepest feelings and choices. Our Lord made it very clear that holiness cannot be understood or lived apart from these demands. So, my dear friends, as we are going to, as I said at the beginning, we are in the general election soon, most probably in April or May, then we ask to consider all the norms that the party of Christ gives us and how we choose to the party of Jesus as our own ideology, so that Christ will always judge us according to his promises given to us. As I was saying, many politicians, they give a lot of promises, they don't accomplish them. But Christ promised to us a holy life and happiness, even if we suffer. The last beatitude is quite difficult to accept. If you are persecuted, then in my name I will be there, and the kingdom of God will be yours. We know there have been plenty of people who have suffered in their life. There are plenty of martyrs in the church, in the life of the church, and starting from the beginning, the first martyrs, and many others up to today, who give their life for the kingdom of God, which is the party that Jesus proposes to all of us to follow with faith, with enthusiasm, even if we had to suffer, with hope for a better future in our life and the life of our brothers and sisters around us.